Hello everyone! In this week's video, I'm showing how I create comic or manga pages in Clip Studio Paint. Speaking of Clip Studio Paint, I want to thank them for sponsoring this video. If you don't know what Clip Studio Paint is, it is my favorite drawing software. I have been using variations of Clip Studio Paint since I was 14 years old. And I have never felt the need to switch to something else. It has everything I need. Tons of materials and brushes that you can customize to make your own. Or you can even make your own. Just in case you can't find any materials or brushes that meet your specific needs. And if you want to try Clip Studio Paint for yourself, they have up to a 6-month free trial depending on your device. There's a link to it in the description. I have used Clip Studio Paint for creating all of my comics, like I Want to Be a Magical Girl, My Next Door Neighbors, and my short light novel that I'm currently working on. Today I'll be showing how I create comics in Clip Studio Paint. So let's get started. So first we need to set up our file. I am using Clip Studio Paint EX, so this area may look a little different if you are using Clip Studio Paint Pro. In the EX version of Clip Studio Paint, I can make a file that contains multiple page files. To do this, I'm going to go to Show All Comic Settings. There are these other ones for comics, but I prefer this one because it lets me see all of the settings. As you can see, there are a lot of settings. I don't want to bore you too much, so I'm only going to cover the settings I most often use or change. Under Preset, you can choose from a bunch of preset guidelines for manga pages. You can even find presets for Shonen Jump and other publishers. Today, I'll choose this one for my presets. Also, you can change the unit of measurement here. I'm going to change it to inches. So let's take a look at the canvas section. Here we can change the width, height, and resolution of the canvas. You may notice that the canvas preview has these blue lines. These are our print guidelines. We'll go over what these mean in a little bit. Base expression color lets us choose if the comic will be in color, gray, or monochrome. I often set it to color even if I'm working in black and white. I can change the basic expression color of layers within the page files later if I want to. In manga draft settings, we can change the setting of the print guidelines. If you're planning to publish with a certain publisher or print with a certain printer, you should follow their guidelines and change these accordingly. Lastly, we have multiple pages. Here I can decide how many pages I want to create. I'm going to set this to a really low number since this is only for an example. Right here, I can pick which side the binding is on, and also which side the first page is on. If you're printing for reading from left to right, like a manga, the binding is on the right and the starting page is on the left. If you want to print like an American comic, the binding is on the left and the first page is on the right. I'm going to have it set for reading from left to right like an American comic since that's what I often do. So now we have our story file with the pages for our comic. I'm going to double click on the first page to open it. Now we have our page with the printing guidelines. If you don't plan to get your comic printed or you're making a webcomic or webtoon, you can ignore these if you want. You can turn them off by going to View and then Crop Mark / Default Border. So you might be wondering what these blue lines mean. They can be a little confusing, but I'll try my best to explain them. So this area out here is all going to get cut off when the book is printed. So you shouldn't have something you want the reader to see in this area because it's going to get cut off. Next, we have the small area between these two lines. This is called bleed. Printers aren't 100% accurate when they are cutting the paper, and there are often small variations in where the paper is being cut. This bleed area is where the printer will try to cut the paper. If you have panels or art that you want to have extend to the edge of the page, you should extend it past the bleed area. By extending your art or panel past the bleed area, you'll ensure there won't be any random blank space around the edges of your comic page. This area is the final trimmed size of your book, so this will be the final size of the book. And this area is the safe area. You want to try to keep all important information like dialogue in this area to ensure that it doesn't get cut off. Every printer has its own printing guidelines. I recommend looking at a few printers that you think you may want to print with and follow their guidelines. So enough about printing, settings, and guidelines. Let's get into the fun stuff. drawing the comic pages. So the first thing you're gonna want is some kind of script. That way you have an idea of what content the pages of your comic will contain. My scripts are usually pretty simple. I break it up into pages and list who is talking and what they are saying. Sometimes I include extra information if I think it is needed, like an establishing shot of the school or character opens the door. I just write anything I feel like I will need when I'm going to be doing the storyboards. If you are a writer working with an artist, you may want to add more information to the script. In this scene, my character is talking to her friend Mr. Froggy while studying a book. Now that I have an idea of what content my page will contain, I'll start working on the storyboard. So storyboards are basically just a really rough idea of how I want to lay out the panels, the word balloons, and the characters. I always keep these pretty rough, that way it's easy to change them. If I want to change the layout of the page, I don't feel bad for getting rid of my previous idea because it was just super quick and sketchy and didn't have anything finished in it. So let's take a moment to talk about panels. When you're a beginner, figuring out how to lay out panels can be really tricky and it can be hard to find a good flow. You want to try to guide the viewer in a kind of zigzag motion. Panels control the pacing of your comic. If you want things to feel faster, like we are jumping from action to action, using more panels on one page can give us a sense of that. But if there are scenes that you want to make an impact or make them feel important, using fewer panels or making those panels larger can help do that. It seems like shonen manga often averages more panels than shoujo manga, but each artist is different. I tend to average around 4 or 5 panels per page. This is a pretty safe number to aim for. Of course, you can use more or less. Just make sure your layout is easy to understand. You don't want the reader wondering which panel they read next. So now that I have my storyboard, we can start adding the panels. Making panels in Clip Studio Paint is really easy. They even have pre-made panel layouts if you don't want to create your own. To find them, go to the Material window. Then go to Manga Material, then Framing Template. To use these, you just drag and drop and ta-da! You have panels! If you click on the panels, you can even change their sizes to how you want them. If you want to create your own panels from scratch, you can go to the Framing Border tool. Here we have three different tools. The Rectangle Frame that makes square and rectangle panels. The Polyline Frame. We can make many different shapes with this. The lines can be straight or curved. And lastly is the frame border pen. You can draw any shape you want with this. The nice thing about the panel tools is that they automatically create a mask so that you can't draw outside of the panel while you are in the panel folder. However, you can turn off the mask by right-clicking on the mask and then turning off Enable Mask. So now you can draw outside of the panel if you want to. Oh, also, you can change the line width of the panel here. I often like to use the Cut Frame Border tool to create multiple panels. Divide Frame Folder creates a new folder for each panel when you cut it. Divide Frame Border also divides the frame, but it doesn't create a new folder. You can change how large you want the cut to be with these sliders. Okay, now we have our panels. Next, we will add the word balloons. I prefer to add word balloons before working on the art, because sometimes the balloons take up more or less space than I expected. Clip Studio Paint has many pre-made word balloons to choose from, and I often use them. You can find them by going to Material, Manga Material, Balloon, then just drag and drop. You can scale them and transform them to your liking. If you want to modify the shape, you can go to Correct Line, and then Control Point. This will let you move around the different points of the balloon. You can also make your own balloons by going to the Balloon tool. You can make an ellipse balloon, a custom-shaped curved balloon, or draw your own balloon. You can also add balloon tails. You can change the way the tails form here. For polyline and spleen, or spline, I'm not sure how to say it, you double-click the mouse when you want them to end. To add my dialogue, I use the text tool. You can choose different fonts here and change the size here. When adding word balloons to pages, I try to think of how I'm using them to guide the viewer's eye. I want the balloons to lead the viewer where I want them to go, and help guide them from panel to panel. I often do a lot of small tweaking and moving around while doing this. Okay, now that we finally have all of the setup done, we can start drawing. I'm starting off by sketching the panels and refining them more. Like I mentioned before, I'm drawing my original character Pariah and her friend Mr. Froggy. Pariah is one of my older original characters. I have a story for her in my head, but I've never actually gotten around to creating it. Maybe someday. I actually changed the style I draw Pariah in recently. I used to draw her in my normal style, but I thought she might look cute in what I call my chibi elf style. I like to draw these simple chibi-ish elves in my sketchbook, and they're really fun to draw. And I thought Pariah might be a good fit for this style because she has always been a fairy-like creature. After sketching, I move on to the line art. I usually use the G pen for my line art because I like how sharp and clean it is, but for this page I thought it'd be fun to experiment and use the textured pen. You can use whatever pen or pencil you want for your line art. Feel free to experiment and find what works best for you. Sometimes people ask me what pen size I use for my line art, and I can never really answer this because what size I use depends on how large the canvas is. I kinda just feel it out and try to find a size that feels right. For our black and white comics, I like to add screen tones for shading. Screen tones are gray areas made up of dots. There are a few ways you can create them in Clip Studio Paint. You can select an area and then click New Tone. This window pops up for the screen tone settings. Frequency changes how many lines of shapes we get. Density changes how dense the pattern is. The denser the pattern, the darker it is. Type lets you select what shape you want the screen tone to be. I often go with circles. Another way you can create a screen tone is to fill in an area with a shade of gray that you like, and then go to the Layer Property window, then click Tone. This will convert the gray into a screen tone. You can also change the frequency and shape. Lastly, you can go to Materials, Monochromatic Pattern, and then Basic to find many different screen tones. In this case, I am using different shades of gray instead of screen tones because I'm only going to be viewing this on the computer, and I often find screen tones on the computer to feel a little too busy. However, if I was planning to print this, I'd probably convert all of these gray tones into screen tones. So here's the page in black and white. If I wanted to make it a colored comic like my webcomic, I start by filling in the colors with the fill tool. For my webcomic, I have a color palette filled with the colors for my characters. That way I'm always using the same colors. I'll quickly show you how to make your own color palette. So I start by finding the color palette tab, then clicking the settings button, and then add new settings. I then rename it to what I want it, and then click OK. Now we have this blank palette to save colors to. To save a color, right-click on a square and then select Replace Color. This is very handy for coloring comics. Everyone has their own shading style. I keep things pretty simple for my comics. I make a layer above my color layer and set it to Multiply. I use a dark muted color for my cell shading. I often use a dark muted magenta for warmer colors, and a dark blue for cool colors. I'll occasionally add gradients if I want things to feel more fancy. When I was inking this page, I was planning for it to be in black and white instead of color, but I thought you might like seeing my coloring process. If I had planned for this to be a colored page, I think I would have made my line art a little bit different, maybe a little thinner and a little less prominent. So here's the finished page in black and white and in color. So that is how I create a comic in Clip Studio Paint. I hope this video is helpful to you and that you enjoyed it. Thank you all so much for watching, and thank you so much again to Clip Studio Paint for sponsoring this video. I'll see you all next week. Bye!